We've all been there. You're standing in a museum staring at a painting and all you can think is, I don't get it. To me, knowing the story behind an artwork is a huge part of knowing how to look at it. I'm Amanda, the host of the Art of History podcast, where we view history through the lens of some really great works of art. Each episode, we dive deep into the bigger picture behind some familiar and maybe not so familiar pieces. Check out Art of History now wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey there, I'm Tyler, the host of Wake Me Up, the only guided morning routine podcast. No matter how you'd like to start your day, Wake Me Up has something for everyone. Whether you'd like a calming meditation, some easy yoga and stretching to wake your body, or an inspirational talk to get you motivated for the day, you can find all of it on Wake Me Up. So trade the snooze button for an episode of Wake Me Up and see how your days change. Just search Wake Me Up and your favorite podcast player.
Recorded in Chicago, Illinois, with your hosts, Ken, Matt, Neal, and Jeff, this is Triviality.
Hello and welcome to Triviality, the game where a lack of seriousness meets a little bit of knowledge. My name is Neal and today is a special bonus episode for the main feed. It is a Major League Baseball bonus episode, all sports. How does that make you feel, Matt?
It's about time.
It is. You've been sending your letters to the Triviality office, even though you work here, to get a sports episode. And since it is October, it is baseball playoff time, and what better time to do a bonus episode about baseball than today? Matt, I believe Ken and Jeff aren't here. Any reason that they're not here?
They don't like sports.
They do. They don't like sports. They even just said they didn't want to be here unless there was some sort of chance spell or potion involved, like magic, but there isn't, unfortunately. So, but thank you to both of them for supporting us in all of our endeavors. But Matt, we do have a special co-host here today with us. They wrote all the questions. They're going to be hosting all the questions, which we're super grateful for. If you haven't heard his show before, you should check it out right away, especially if you're a sports fan. If you're not, there is still some wonderful personalities on the show that you should check out from the Benchwarmers Trivia Podcast, one of our own patrons, Matt Dougherty. How are you, Matt?
Thanks. I'm doing great. Thank you very much for having me, guys. And just to clarify, I did not write all of these. These were supplied by the majority of the Benchwarmers and my good friend and our Lord and Savior, Ryan Myers.
Awesome. Well, that means we got the full Benchwarmers experience then. They're going to be across the board in difficulty and flavor, I guess, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's do the rules for everyone at home so they know what they're in for, and then we'll introduce the players.
Okay. So we have a total of 30 questions with three participants. That would be 10 questions for each participant. The participant's going to go ahead and select a number between 1 and 10, and that's going to give me the number on my spreadsheet of what's the question that they want. Each question is worth 1 point, and they are difficulty ranked, number 1 being the easiest and number 10 being the hardest on their list. And then they'll have the opportunity to steal also. So based off of my individual question to a person, and then the person in order of alphabetical order by their first name, the next person will have the opportunity to steal. And then if that person doesn't get it, rolls out a third person. And then if it's unbelievably hard, then we can play David Lux for all of the hard questions. So.
Well, thank you for explaining the rules. Thank you to all the Benchwarmers for helping write those questions along with our friend Ryan Myers. Make sure to check out Benchwarmers Trivia Podcast and all your favorite podcast apps. But let's get to our introductions. Our first player coming to us from Oakland, California. I'm not sure if Billy Bean chose him for this podcast, but he's coming to us from Oakland. We're super happy to have him here, and that is Mark Kim. How are you, Mark?
Hey, how's it going, everyone?
Good, good. Please tell us a little bit about yourself, and then I'll lead into that other question as soon as you're done.
Yeah, I'm born and raised in Oakland, California area. I'm a big A's fan, and I am a PE teacher, actually. So don't really teach the kids baseball usually. That's a little unsafe for kids K through 8, but yeah.
Well, how often are you doing home run derby at school?
Man, if we had glass that was more impact proof, probably all the time, but unfortunately, there's some safety factors to that. So,
well, thank you for being here. And we'll get back to the other questions I said, which I think everyone at home will enjoy. Let's go to our next competitor coming to us from Providence, Rhode Island. Ian Michaud, how's it going?
It's going well. Yeah, so I'm Ian. I grew up in New Hampshire, so I've been kind of in the Northeast, moved up and down the East Coast my whole life. Right now, I'm an equipment manager for the New England Revolution, MLS team. And yeah, I mean, it's funny because I've never played soccer. I've always played baseball, football, track. So now I'm excited to get going on this one.
That's awesome. Keeping the soccer / football spirit alive in America with the revolution. That's awesome, though. Yeah, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
All right, and our last competitor coming to us basically right down the block, but because he's a secret agent and we don't want anyone but the government knowing where he's located, we're just going to say he's from Chicago. He's an Oakland 5 patron on Patreon, and that is David Kantorski. How are you, David?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
Of course. Tell us about yourself.
Yeah, as you mentioned, David, down the street from you. I kind of love baseball, kind of excited for this episode. Growing up on the South Side, I do have the White Sox in my blood, but I have also switched over, and I'm also a big Red Sox fan as well. And then, yeah, I also do computer sales for small businesses. That's kind of what pays the bills for me. So
that's awesome. Just to get into the baseball spirit, you heard the rules. We're about to start the game, but we had a little fun question just to get a personality of everyone, because loving baseball is such a unique pastime, pun intended, because a lot of kids or people collect cards. They go to the games, they collect jerseys, what have you. And everyone loves different players. So I asked everyone here today, we'll get to me and both Matts at halftime, but I asked everyone here today to basically pick a team of their favorite players of all time, not necessarily a team that would win and go undefeated in a season of all-time play, but just your favorite players. And that's going to be a starting lineup, including a starting pitcher, one reliever, and a DH. And let's start with Mark. Who is your list of your favorite players?
All right. So I went in the fantasy kind of order. So catcher, I chose Piazza. First base, I chose McGuire, but was very tempted to choose Pujols because my dad's from St. Louis. Second base, Brandon Phillips. I really loved watching him in the late 2000s, early 2010s. Jimmy Rollins for shortstop because he is from here. He's from Alameda, California, which is next to Oakland. Third base, David Wright. Left field, pretty obvious, Ricky Henderson. Center field, I actually chose Cespedes. That was one of my favorite periods of years when Cespedes was with us in Oakland. Right field is a division rival, but still one of the greatest of all time. It's kind of obvious too. It's Ichiro. Starting pitcher, I did not choose Dave Stewart, and I really wanted to. But growing up, my dad would always talk about Bob Gibson all the time. So I love Bob Gibson. DH, I chose Poppy, actually. Big Poppy. One of my favorites to watch of all time. So props to you, David. And also closer. This one's a little obvious too. I'm an A's fan. Eckersley all the way.
That's a great, awesome, great lineup. Mine is garbage. I can't wait to come out.
Oh, I can't wait to hear yours too. So let's see. Ian, what's your list?
So I grew up as a Yankees fan, so there's going to be a good amount of Yankees there, but I do value a lot of speed in my lineup. So I started out with catcher with Pudge Rodriguez. A lot of these early 2000s guys, except for my first baseman, who is Lou Gehrig. He went to Columbia. I did my grad school there, so big fan. Second base, Alfonso Soriano. I loved watching him. Mm-hmm. Just those couple years in New York, he was on fire. Third base, Chipper Jones, I felt like was just like an easy answer for me. Just the greatness that he is. Me being a Yankees fan in New England, Derek Jeter made me the Yankees fan in New England. So he's at shortstop easily. Left field, like I said, I value speed. So Ricky Henderson's also my left fielder. I love the stolen bases.
Ricky Henderson would pick Ricky Henderson too.
Exactly. center field, Ken Griffey Jr. You can't go wrong. Mm-hmm. Right field, Ichiro, just a classic. Starting pitcher, I don't know why. I just immediately just Randy Johnson came to mind. Just, you know, the hitting a bird is just, who else has done that?
His bird hitting ability.
Exactly. Now he's an NFL photographer. That guy's just the most interesting person. Mm-hmm. Relief pitcher, again, early 2000s. Got to be Mariano. And then my DH, although he didn't really play it, I went with Hank Aaron, just model of consistency. Can't go wrong.
He would be a good DH. 100%.
Exactly. He moved to DH later in his career.
No, he did.
Yeah.
See, you're already showing me the knowledge.
Yeah, plus one point.
great list. And then last list before we start, let's see what you got, David.
Yeah, sounds like I might be a little bit older than you guys, because my list is more the 80s, 90s. As I mentioned, White Sox and Red Sox behind the plate, you got to go with the original Pudge, Carlton Fisk.
Mm-hmm.
At first base, back in 04, he said it to about the Yankees, Kevin Millar. They needed to close him out on game four. Sticking in Boston, second base, Dustin Pedroia. He's just so exciting to watch. Third base, I'm going to come back to Chicago. Grew up a huge Robin Ventura fan. Shortstop, I'm going to go with the Iron Man himself, Cal Ripken Jr. I didn't specify left, center, or right, so I just threw three outfielders out there. First of all, Tony Gwynn, just an amazing athlete and player. Bo Jackson, just because why not? Mm-hmm. You know? He actually did a signing once, and a part of the signing, he said he will not sign the shoulder pads and bat photo for anybody. So don't even bring it. It was interesting. So, and last in outfield, Jose Canseco. I know there's that whole error, but he admitted it. So thinking about on the mound for your starting pitcher, I went back and forth. And I went with Nolan Ryan. You know, I don't think there's anybody better than that. For my closer, I like the crazy one over and that helped us win a couple World Series in Boston, Jonathan Papelbon. And then for DH, a little bit of a nod to my son who plays baseball and loves Vladimir Guerrero Jr. I am picking Vladimir Guerrero Sr. since I am his father. So
nice.
Yep.
Well, great lists from everyone. Those were all good. We'll get to me, Matt, and Matt at halftime. But let's just get into the questions here. You heard the rules. Let's throw it to Matt Dougherty, and we're going to go in order of alphabetical spelling. So David, Ian, Mark, and take it away, Matt.
Awesome. All right, David, 1 through 10. What do you want first?
You know what? I'm going to go with let's go with number 5.
Number 5, here we go. I find it very interesting that Major League Baseball allows teams to set up partnerships with a sports betting app these days, but a certain someone remains out of the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame. Okay, off of my soapbox today and on to my question about Pete Rose. Rose played for 3 franchises in his career. Which team was he playing for in April of 1984? When he reached his 4,000th major league hit.
And as soon as you started with the sport betting, I knew it was Pete Rose. And now I'm just like, 1984. I want to say he was back in Cincinnati at that time. And I'm going to say the Reds.
That is incorrect. We will move on to Ian.
This is tough for me because it was before my time. So
if that's going to be an excuse for you, Ian, then this entire game is probably not going to be great for anybody. I'm just going to say it right now.
Oh, no. Here we go. honestly, I...
Do you even know what 3 teams he played for?
Exactly. I don't. I would have to throw out, honestly, I'm going to say the White Sox.
That is incorrect. On to Mark.
I'm going to guess Phillies.
Well, we got 2 of the 3 teams, but we did not get the 3rd team. It happened at the Olympic Stadium in Montreal, and it was against the Philadelphia Phillies, but the answer is the Montreal Expos.
That can't be true. Fact check.
Later in 1984, Rose would be traded back to the Reds, where he finished his career in 1986.
See, I was close then, right?
Yeah, you got 1 of the 3, that's for sure. Okay, so we got 1 point from Mark, and we're moving on to Ian. Ian, 1 through 10, what do you want?
Let's go with 10.
Number 10 right out of the gate. Here we go. Name the 2 all-time hitting greats, one in the AL, one in the NL, both of whom are synonymous with the one franchise that they ever played for, who hit the first two walk-off home runs in Major League Baseball All-Star Game history. And I'm just going to say right now, this is, since you don't like old-timey baseball, this is going to be a rough one for you, bud.
Yeah, it's honestly.
How about this? Because this was you picked the hardest one. How about you just name one of the two?
Name half of the two. Half of the one of the two.
I'll go with Chipper Jones.
That is incorrect. On to you, Mark. How about this? We'll go back to Ian. You can name two, and even if you get one of the ones from the naming two. And this is what happens when you pick number 10 first, I'm just saying. So pick another one.
I get a break. Okay, another one quick. I'll go with Piazza.
No. Mark?
I'm going to guess Reggie Jackson.
No. Another one? Another guess?
Shremsky?
No. That's close, but no. David?
The close is making me think a little bit differently now.
I shouldn't have said that. Sorry.
I know.
Disregard.
Yeah, disregard.
He wasn't close. Way off.
It's two, one in each league. I had an AL guess, which I think Ian would be quite upset. I'm going to toss it out there and say Derek Jeter.
No, not Derek Jeter. Nope.
Okay.
You want to do another one real quick there, David?
I'm then going to go Ted Williams.
Ted Williams is correct. I don't know, guys. Do we want to give him points? I kind of give him a hint there with the...
I think so. I mean, everyone got two guesses, I guess, right? So
yeah, it was Ted Williams and Stan Musial was the other one.
Stan the man.
Ted Williams in 1941, Stan Musial in 1955. But we'll move on now, and that was Ian, so we'll move on to Mark. 1 through 10, my friend.
7.
Number 7. Here we go. In 1979... who signed the first Major League Baseball contract averaging more than $1 million per year? The headline said that he could have bought his own jet, but he preferred another mode of transportation.
John Madden on his bus.
I don't know why, but Bonds just comes to mind immediately, so I'm going to guess Barry Bonds.
That is not correct. David.
And of course, you get on the mic and the IQ drops. I cannot think of the first name. But I'm going to go with Schmidt from the Philadelphia Phillies.
Mikey.
Mike Schmidt is not correct. We'll move on to Ian.
I don't know why it popped in my head, but I want to say Joe Morgan.
Ooh, nope. Joe Morgan is not correct either. Ooh, guys, if number 7 is going to give us, we're going to have a tough time tonight. But let's hopefully some of these will click with us. Let's hope this is internet crash and burn. No, because it was he was more into the Ryan Express. This is Nolan Ryan.
Oh.
Ooh.
Yeah, originally it was no context around there, and I added the mode of transportation, thinking that people would know that he was nicknamed the Nolan Express. But
so they had a Robin Ventura beating clue. Then everyone
yeah,
would have
exactly.
Got it.
Yeah.
I would have had that one.
And thanks to Eric Walling for writing that one. Eric Walling, who is in love with Nolan Ryan, and his son is actually named Nolan. I wonder who that's after.
Christopher Nolan.
Likes Inception. Yeah.
Big Christopher Nolan fan.
We're going to head it back. Oh, by the way, there's a fantastic Nolan Ryan documentary on Netflix. If you haven't checked it out, it is very, very cool to watch. Gives you the tingles when you watch about one of his last no-hitters where the stadium filled. It wasn't on local TV, but people heard it over the radio, and people filled the stadium that was almost empty. It was pretty crazy. But we'll move on to David. David, excluding number 5, 1 through 10.
You got to get the easy ones out of the way, so let's go with 4. Just work backwards.
Number 4. What pitcher owns the freakishly good accomplishment of being the first pitcher to win the Cy Young Award in each of his first two full seasons? He is also one of only two pitchers in Major League Baseball history to win multiple Cy Young Awards, World Series, throw multiple no-hitters, and earn multiple All-Star selections, the other being Sandy Koufax.
Some reason I'm thinking this is really deep and old. And unfortunately, I don't know when the Cy Young Award actually was officially started. I'm going to go really deep and go Walter Johnson.
Walter Johnson is not the correct answer. On to Ian.
It's a good guess, though.
I think I got it. Is it Tim Lincecum?
It is Tim Lincecum.
Let's go.
Picked up on the hint at the front there. He owns the freakishly good accomplishment.
Big time Timmy Jim.
All right, well, we're going to move on to Ian. You just got the steal, and here you go. To make a great play in the field, and you're up to bat. What are you going to do? You can hit a dinger. Come on. What do we got?
Let's go for eight.
Number eight. Jeez, you're just like a glutton for punishment.
Get him alive. Please, get it out of the way.
You're going to love the start of this question, my friend. In 1934,
pass.
Major League Baseball adopted a league-wide standard for baseballs they used. As a part of that, there was a standard for the number of seams or stitches allowed in the ball within 10. How many seams are on a Major League Baseball?
I feel like I used to know this. 510.
510 is incorrect. Mark?
I actually did used to know this too. I think it's much lower. My guess is going to be 218.
218 is also incorrect. David?
See, I've always taught that there was the half seam and the full seam. So I had two numbers in mind. So if 218 is not correct, that means 108 would be the correct answer you are looking for, I believe.
And David nailed it. It is 108. And yes, that's why it's important that I put down seam, because the seam is the two stitches combined. So, all right. So David getting the points there.
So after after five, looks like we have David with two and Ian with one. So still close.
Pitcher's duel. Good job, Matt.
Yeah, exactly. It's great as a trivia host to like blank everyone. Moving on to Mark. Mark, what number would you like?
Like the average audience person, I'm probably just going to, let's do one so like the audience can like yell at us
there
if
you
get it wrong.
What is the team name of the fictional professional baseball team on The Simpsons that has since been adopted as a AAA affiliate to the Colorado Rockies?
Right audience.
Springfield Isotopes?
The AAA team's not in Springfield. They're in a different town, but I'll give it to you. That's fine.
Sorry, Albuquerque Isotopes. And
there you
right?
go.
Yeah, I only know that because of Better Call Saul, honestly.
All right, fantastic. Hey, we're moving right along here. Now back over to David. What do you got, sir?
Let's go with number six.
Number six. Oh, no. Oh, I should have removed all references to the Red Sox here for all your questions, but I didn't know about your fandom. So what former Red Sox player is the only player known to have played in the Little League World Series, the College World Series, the Major League World Series, the Olympics, and the World Baseball Classic?
Oh, as soon as you started listing it, I knew it. And now it's his name is escaping me. I'm going to feel really dumb, but Jason Veritek.
Jason Veritek is the correct answer.
All right.
Moving on to Ian. You have taken 8 and 10. Are you going to continue this punishment, or are you going to go for a little easier stuff now?
Let's go for 9.
All right.
Get out of there. Let's go. Keep going.
What was the nickname of the Red Bullpen consisting most prominently of Norm Charlton, Rob Dibble, and Randy Myers that helped lead the Reds to the 1990 World Series? 1990 being probably 5 to 10 years before Ian was born.
Just five.
Okay, good.
God. I
graduated high school in 1995, so. For all those in this visual media, I just flipped them off. So.
I was just talking about this today, actually, and now it's just out. The Rumbling Reds. I don't know.
The Rumbling Reds is incorrect. Mark?
I might know this because they beat the A's in that World Series, and I will never get over it. Just kidding. I was probably 8 months old. Anyways. I believe it was called the Big Red Machine.
That is also incorrect. Big Red Machine being the 1972 Reds. David?
For some reason, I cannot pull the nickname. But obviously, I'm just going to take a wild guess and say the Red Curtain.
Nope. All three wrong answers. The answer is the Nasty Boys.
The Nasty Boys. Triviality's nickname.
I love that.
And just to clarify, the Big Red Machine was pretty much the Reds through the 1970s, not just 1972. Mm. But
the Red Curtain would be a really cool name for their bullpen, though.
See?
Ideas. This is what we're good at. Ideas, just not baseball trivia. Moving back over to Mark, what number would you like next?
I'll join the crowd with number 8.
Number 8. Since 1964, What team has won 25% of all American League batting titles? They sealed this with Louis Arraez's 316 average this last season, which prevented Aaron Judge from winning the Triple Crown.
I'll just guess Angels.
Not the Angels. Nope. Over to David.
The last day of the season was painful this year because I fell out of contention of my fantasy playoffs. But I'm trying to look at that name, and Louis Arraez, I believe, is a Houston Astro. So I'm going to go Houston Astros.
Houston Astro is also incorrect. Ian?
Ooh.
The Twins?
Louis Arraez is a natural second baseman who sometimes plays left field and also can play first base for my beloved Minnesota Twins.
Hey, there you go.
Yep. He does the rolling of the R's with a double R. So when they announce him, they say Louis Arraez. So that's the right way to pronounce his name. And I have a T-shirt that says All Arraez.
Oh, I like that.
Oh, I'm not funny. All right, moving on to David. We have 4, 5, and 6 taken. Otherwise, you can select any other one you want.
Let's go 8. Why not?
Number 8. Who is the first Major League live-action mascot introduced in 1964, just 2 years after the team's first game?
I'm trying to think of teams that came in the 60s that have a mascot. I keep picturing either Southpaw or the Fanatic, and that's all I got. And I know, obviously, it's not Southpaw.
Clark the Cub? No one likes Clark.
I grew up on the South Side. Wrigley's like a minor league team, you know? Philly Fanatic.
That is incorrect. Ian?
I can't even range a guess. Philly Fanatic was the only one that I could really pull off the top of my head, so I'll probably just pass on this one.
Okay. Mark?
Is it Mr. Met?
Starting in 1962 as a printed version, but when they moved to Shea Stadium in 1964, they put a big old ball on a dude's head, and they called him Mr. Met.
Great pull.
So we're moving on now to Ian. You basically have 1 through 7 to pick from.
Go to 6.
Number 6. What Indians/Guardians star homered in front of his home fans to help the AL win the 1997 All-Star game at Jacobs Field?
I'm trying to think of
right in Neil's wheelhouse, his favorite Indians team of all time.
This is me. Yeah, this is for me.
I didn't know you're a Cleveland fan.
I've been a Cleveland fan since I was a little kid.
Oh,
he loved Major League.
That's true.
It's wrong. I had it and then I lost it. I don't know why. It's not, but I'm going to go Jim Thome.
Jim Thome is not correct. Mark?
This is my favorite Cleveland player of all time.
What was the big baddie dude that was from the Yankees in Major League? The guy who would always try to hit his spit with the bat when he was up in the slow motion of him swinging.
I thought that was Rookie of the Year when he strikes him out with the floater.
There you go. All right, we're just delaying now for Mark to give him more time. Mark, do you have an idea?
So much time. Neil even gave me a hint, and I really am. I'm just gonna tap.
David.
I had two names in mind, and I couldn't decipher. One actually was Jim Thome. I said, thank you, Ian. So I'll go with my second guess of Manny Ramirez.
That's a good guess, but it is not correct. It is Sandy Alomar Jr. Oh, I should have handed that over to you, didn't Neil? Sorry about that.
No, I would have said it. Yeah, that's my favorite player of all time. And Clue Haywood was the name of the Yankees player for Major League.
There you go, Haywood. Yeah. Oh, and Matt, think of this here while we're doing this. Another question about that show. What was the manager doing for a job before he took the job as the head, as the manager of the Cleveland Indians? And we'll move on to Mark.
Let's do 6.
There are only 2 left-handed hitting Hall of Famers in history that had at least 2,700 hits, hit at least 475 home runs, and won at least one MVP. Amazingly, they were both born in Donora, Pennsylvania, a town of fewer than 5,000, and they share the same birthday, November 21st, though 49 years apart. And Matt, do you know what the manager was doing before he took the job?
I don't know.
He was selling.
Wasn't he coaching the Mudheads?
No, he was selling white wall tires at a place in Toledo. He answered the phone. He says, like, I got a great deal on some white walls. All right, Mark.
Well, the homers are what's making me think it's one of them is Bonds. So I'm going to guess Barry Bonds for one of them.
Okay. And the other one?
I am at a blank, so I'll just guess Babe Ruth.
Okay. Neither one of those probably are wrong. Correct. So let's go ahead and move over to David.
I'm drawing massive blanks here. And initially, I was going to say Ken Griffey Jr., which I know his dad's not 49 years older. So we'll lock that in and keep the game moving.
Okay. That's incorrect. Ian?
It's going to make me mad when you read the answers, because I don't want to delay any more than I should, because it's just going to be a lot of hemming and hawing. So I'm just going to tap, because it's just so much that isn't working right now.
Sure. Well, David, you did have one correct there, Ken Griffey Jr., and the other one was Stan Musial.
Stan the man, again.
Stan actually played high school baseball with Ken's grandfather, Buddy Griffin.
2,700 hits is a very significant signifier in that one, because Ted Williams is real close to hitting that threshold, because he's left-handed, hit over 500 homers.
Now, we're about a little over 10 questions, just for the score. So we got 3 for David, 2 for Ian, 2 for Mark. And you know what? I think, like Major League Baseball, they're making the time to pitch a little bit shorter. We're going to get rid of the steal. So now we're just going to get as many questions as possible to reach the end here. So no more stealing. It's just going to be question after question.
I think it's going to get easier now, because everyone picked the harder questions as their front end. So
you guys all get a start with a runner on second.
Exactly.
There you go.
That's the new rule.
And that was Mark that had that last one, if I recall correctly. So we're back over to David. So David, you have 1, 2, 3, 7, 9, and 10 left.
My ADD does not like that 7 being out there. So let's knock that one out.
Who did the Baltimore Orioles take with the first overall draft pick in 2022? He is the son of a former 7-time All-Star left fielder.
Jackson Holliday.
That is correct.
Wow. I'm old.
I know, right? When I saw that Matt Holliday had a kid that was in the majors, I was like, what? Or not, maybe he's not in the majors yet.
Nope, but, not possible.
Yep.
All right, over to Ian. You've got 1 through 5 and 7 out there.
I'll go to 1.
1. What very soon to be retired Major League Baseball player was the first in history to hit 330 home runs in his first 2 seasons?
I'd go with Pujols on that one.
Albert Pujols is correct. Moving right along.
All right.
Over to Mark.
Let's do 2.
Number 2. What pitch was previously known as the dry spitter due to the similarly surprising motion of this pitch, and was later perfected by such greats as Charlie Huff, Hoyt Wilhelm, and Tim Wakefield?
Knuckleball.
Knuckleball is correct.
Now we're getting points here.
Yeah, right. Now we're moving right along. It's all Ian's fault picking all those high numbers right off the bat. Okay, moving on to David. What do you want? 1, 2, 3, 9, and 10.
I guess we'll stick with the easy ones and go 3.
Number 3. What World Series champion and 3-time Cy Young winner is certainly the most famous Major League Baseball player all time with heterochromia? I didn't even read this one now until just right now, and I didn't realize. maybe I should have some flavor text on what heterochromia is, because I don't really even know.
Well, that kind of triggered me to give a solid answer. I just wanted to kind of think and make sure that all the other parts matched up. But when I think of heterochromia, I think of Max Scherzer and his 2 different colored eyes.
Mm-hmm. There you go. Yep, Max Scherzer is the correct answer.
See?
There you go.
And I got you flavor text there.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah, I Googled it real quick and I was like, oh, awesome. Moving on to Ian. You got 2 through 5 and 7.
7.
Number 7. What former Yankee and former Major League Baseball manager set a record for grand slams in a season with 6, though he never hit another one before or after that season in his 14-year career? He also won 9 gold gloves and was a 1980s era AL MVP.
I'm going to go Joe Torre.
Joe Torre is incorrect. Okay, spoiler alerts. I know we're supposed to wait till halftime, Neil, but this is my first baseman, the one with the magical mustache, Don Mattingly.
Wow, shave those sideburns.
Yep. Moving over to Mark, you got 3, 4, 5, 9, and 10.
Yeah, give me 9.
Number 9. An ultimate grand slam, or a walk-off grand slam with a team down 3 runs, is a rare occurrence in baseball, having only popped up 32 times in Major League Baseball history. But 2 teammates managed to pull off this feat within a month of each other this year. Name the 2 AL East teammates that hit ultimate grand slams, one in August and one in September.
Ian's here. I gotta guess. You know who? Giancarlo and Aaron Judge.
You had one correct. It is Giancarlo Stanton and Josh Donaldson. But yeah, good guess though. Good guess. Moving on to David. You have 1, 2, 9, 10.
Let's go with number 9.
Number 9. In 2017, Charlie Blackmon of the Rockies set the record for the most RBIs by a leadoff hitter. The prior record was set in 2000, the first time that a leadoff hitter had 100 RBIs or more. Whose record did Blackmon break?
I cannot recall for certain because back then I kind of stopped watching baseball as much. But for some reason, I'm going to pull out a previous guess and go with Manny Ramirez again.
That is not correct. If I gave you a hint that he's currently the coach of the Nebraska Huskers baseball team.
No.
Even then?
Okay. College isn't going to help me at all.
This is Darren Erstad.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Moving on to Ian. You have 2, 3, 4, 5.
2.
Number 2. What MLB mascot was created after construction began on the team's home stadium and the workers found a number of dinosaur fossils there, including a 7-foot-long Triceratops. It's amazing when you see a word for the first time written out that you haven't seen in a long time. You're like, how do I see those words and stuff?
Triceratops.
Running into mascots again. I got to go with the Philly Fanatic.
No, the answer is not the Philly Fanatic.
I wish we could see.
Now I know. Wait, yep. Hold on. I didn't even think about it. Is it San Diego?
The answer is, okay, so Mark and David, do you guys know this one?
Mark knew it, I think he said, right?
Oh, I know it. Yeah, I know it.
What is it?
It's another name for a home run, Dinger.
Yep, it is Dinger, the Colorado Rockies mascot. It's
so cute.
All right, moving on to, so no points for that, by the way, just, for fun.
Yeah, for fun.
Mark, you've got 3, 4, 5, and 10.
Let's do 5.
5. What major league team is 1-8 in their franchise history and World Series games, having made the series once in the 80s, winning 1 game, and getting swept in the 1990s? Scott Grimes' favorite fictional baseball player played for this team, which makes of no value to the 3 of you because none of you have ever listened to my podcast. So you don't even know who Scott Grimes is, and you don't know the lore about this player. You don't know anything of this stuff. So.
I was going to sell Scott Grimes a bookcase once, and then he never showed up to pick it up.
Oh, now you have to edit that out. Sorry.
I am going to say San Diego Padres.
Yep, and the team that they beat in the 1980s to make it to the World Series in the NLCS was Matt?
Cubbies.
The Chicago Cubs, yeah. It is the San Diego Padres.
That's 84? 1985.
If I recall correctly, 85. I thought it was 85. Yeah. Something like that.
Well, score-wise, we have a nice rising score of 3, 4, and 5. After about 15, 16, I can't remember how many questions we've had, but we've got 3, 4, and 5. And it's sort of a halftime, so let's just get Matt and my's little team lists here, our rosters, and then we'll continue and finish the game. So let's start with Matt Arts, Trivialities Matt.
Yeah, I had a lot of time to think about this, you know, about 20 minutes here. So I really put some effort into it. For catcher, I'm going with AJ Pierzynski, noted puncher of Michael Barrett, who deserved it. That was a really good fight. First base, John Olerud. I love a first baseman that wears a helmet in the field. Second base, Jeff Kent, really good on Survivor. Shortstop, Javi Baez, really good in that body issue. My girlfriend really liked it. Third base, Ron Santo. We love Ron Santo. Right field, Sammy Sosa, best cork in the game. Center field, we got Ken Griffey Jr. Can't go wrong. I love Adam Dunn. He's in left field.
Adam Dunn.
All or nothing. That's how I play. DH, we got Chili Davis, best name in baseball. Starting pitcher, Mike Hampton, got $100 million for being left-handed. I love that. I'm left-handed. And my closing pitcher is the wild man, Rod Beck. I like the hair. It's a good team.
I love it.
I'm not winning any games, but
hey, that's all right. It's a joy to watch though, right? So that's all that matters. Matt Dougherty.
Shockingly, Matt, you and I have a lot of crossovers here. So I'm going to go with the three homers that I got first, because my starting DH is also Chili Davis, and my starting catcher is also AJ Pierzynski.
Wow.
I freaking love AJ Pierzynski. And my starting pitcher is going to be in his prime. I don't, maybe Bob Gibson, maybe Colfax, but in his prime, Johan Santana was the most dominant pitcher in all of baseball. So I'm going to go with Johan. Then a relief pitcher, I'm going to have to agree with you, Mark, Dennis Eckersley. He was dominant. I mean, he was unhittable from like 1987 to 1990. He was crazy. First baseman is going to be Don Mattingly, because that mustache is magical and just want to have fun with that all day long, even though I'm not really into guys, but that's fine. Second base, I'm going to have, I mean, I don't really know that there's a second baseman that I would ever pick over Jackie Robinson. I mean, he's so much considered such a cultural icon that people forget that he was an absolute amazing baseball player. Shortstop, the best shortstop that's ever played the game is Hannes Wagner, and no one can ever prove to me that Hannes Wagner is not the best. Third base, because I have his rookie card and I think he's just totally awesome, is Mike Schmidt. So gotta love Mike Schmidt. In center field, I have the person that everyone says is a racist, but he is not a racist, and that is Ty Cobb. Go back and fact check that. He's not a racist. In right field, I don't know why somebody said he played DH earlier, but I guess he did DH at the end of his career. But Vlad Guerrero Sr. is going to be in my right field, mm-hmm. because that guy's crazy, picking up off of his shoelaces because he was a terrible right fielder. And then in left field, I'm going to have who I think is probably the greatest athlete of his generation, drafted by four separate professional sports leagues, the ABA, NBA, NFL, and Major League Baseball. That is Dave Winfield.
Wow.
Great list. Great list. I'll make mine quick. So I'm probably the most far removed baseball fan here. I was pretty big into it when I played and then kind of stopped at the end of the 90s. But my catcher, as I said, my favorite Cleveland Indian / Guardian of all time, Sandy Alomar Jr. First base, it's a tie kind of, but I'm going to lean towards Jim Thome because I love Jim Thome on Cleveland. But I'm also going to put Frank Thomas there because I was a big fan of Frank Thomas, the Big Hurt. Second base, Jackie Robinson for the same reasons Matt said, but just to add a little bit more local flavor, Ryan Sandberg. Shortstop, always loved Cal Ripken Jr., especially the way he held his bat and managed to get a lot of hits with it being sideways, which I thought was always great. Third base, George Brett, because of all the pine tar. right field, I love Tony Gwynn because of his hitting, but I'm going to give I'm going to give it to Ichiro. I'm a huge fan of Ichiro, bringing great Japanese baseball players to the MLB because there's so many great ones like Hideki Matsui and many others. Center, I was always a huge Willie Mays fan, so Willie Mays gets the edge here, but Kenny Lofton was my second favorite in Cleveland fan, so love Kenny Lofton. And then left field, it was a toss-up between Ted Williams, Ricky Henderson, but I have to go for another Cleveland player, Manny Ramirez, who was a beast. And then my starting pitcher, he might not have thrown the fastest of fastballs, but he was a magician, and I'm going to put Greg Maddux there. And then my reliever, even though he's not a reliever, but he's good enough to be one, Randy Johnson. So that's my list. Oh, and my DH. My DH is Ken Griffey because I couldn't fit him on the list otherwise, but I love Ken Griffey Jr. So
that Johnson coming out of the pen.
Ken Griffey or Ken Griffey Jr.?
Ken Griffey Jr.
Senior. He'd love senior. Ever,
I wonder if he ever did DH. Maybe when he was...
Oh, no, I'm just putting him there just to break the rules.
He DH for the White Sox at the end of his career when he was batting 220 and not hitting very many home runs.
I'll count it.
There you go.
Let me tell you this about Frank Thomas. He owned a brewery in my hometown of Berwyn, and he legit managed it. He was there every night. He's in the back doing the books. He was probably handing out assignments for the wait staff. I don't know. He was always there, though, legit.
He was handing out free testosterone.
Yeah, because now all you have to do is like text jacked to 6969, and you can get some whatever extends or something like that.
Behind every work of art, there's a story. Okay, sure, it sounds kind of obvious when I say it like that, but think about it. How many times have you stood in an art museum, maybe with a date or with your mom, looked at an artwork and thought, I don't get it? I'm Amanda, and I know the feeling all too well. To me, knowing the story behind an artwork is a huge part of knowing how to look at it and appreciate it. And on my podcast, Art of History, that's exactly what I share with you. In each episode, we view history through the lens of some really great works of art. There is so much we can learn about the people and things which someone way back when deemed worthy of recording for posterity. And let me tell you, on the podcast, we have barely scratched the surface. Join me as we dive deep into the bigger picture behind some familiar and maybe not so familiar works of art. No prerequisites required. Check out Art of History wherever you get your podcasts.
Hello everyone, Takuya here.
And I'm Gabby.
And we are the hosts of History of Everything, a podcast which you can probably guess by the name is, well, I mean, it's about everything. Do you want to know why people thought potatoes were evil and would give you syphilis? Are you curious about all the stories of the terrible and stupid ways that people have kicked the bucket over the years? Do you want to hear tales about all of the different badasses of history and the lives that they had brought to life? Well, if so, then look no further. History of Everything is just the right podcast for you. It's available on Spotify, Pandora, and anywhere else that you get your podcast from. Join us for some fun and just see how weird and wacky history can be.
We're back now from halftime, and I think we have the score of 3, 4, and 5. Do you know how many questions we have left, Matt?
Yes, we have a total of 9 questions, 3 for each contestant.
All right, so we're gonna do a rapid round for the final 9 here. So you're not gonna get a ton of time to think about it. So it's gonna be a lot of gut answers here, just to see how we can do it. This is final innings of the game here. Let's see what we can do.
Sounds good. David, 1, 2, or 10?
Let's go with number 2.
Aside from the Seattle Mariners, who have never been, what major league team has the longest drought since their last World Series appearance in 1979?
I believe 1979 would be the Pittsburgh Pirates.
That is correct. Moving on to Ian, 3, 4, or 5? Baseball in Milwaukee is an interesting subject. In 1954, the Boston Braves moved to Milwaukee and then left for Atlanta after the 1965 season. After the 1969 season, the expansion Seattle Pilots moved to Milwaukee and became the Brewers. But there was another incarnation of the Milwaukee Brewers in 1901. That team went on to become the St. Louis Browns, and in 1954, they found their way to their current home, named this AL team. So basically, what current team used to be the St. Louis Browns?
The Nationals.
That is incorrect. The answer is the Baltimore Orioles. Moving on to Mark. You have 3, 4, and 10.
Give me 10.
Yeah, I was going to say, bite the bullet, buddy. While Yankee Stadium is rightfully derided for being so small you can spit out of it, there are actually 3 AL stadiums with shorter left field dimensions than the New York bandbox. Name any one of the 3.
I'm going to say Minute Maid Park.
Minute Maid Park at 315 is correct. Tropicana also has 315 and Fenway has 310. All right, moving on to David. We have 1 and 10, buddy. What do you want?
Well, let's dive in and knock out that 10.
Might as well do it. Who is the only player in Major League Baseball history to lead his respective league in stolen bases for 3 different franchises? He did so by leading the NL while with the Rockies in 2001,
the NL again while with the Marlins in 2003, then the AL while with the White Sox in 2010. Rockies in 2001, Marlins in 2003, White Sox in 2010. Sorry if I said that wrong.
It's quite a gap.
I know we're trying to do a rapid round, and I'm just kind of struggling on this one. I'm going to be wrong and say Ray Durham.
Nope, the answer is Juan Pierre.
There it is.
Oh, wow, I forgot.
Yeah, I was going to say, yes. People forgot about Juan Pierre. Don't ever forget about
him. I forgot he went to Chicago.
Yeah.
All right, moving on to Ian, you have 3 and 4.
I'll go 4.
What color underwear are Major League Baseball umpires required to wear?
Hard-hitting questions.
I'll go with black.
Come to me for the hard-hitting baseball questions. The answer is black. That's correct.
Love that.
Moving on to Mark, you have 3 and 4.
Give me 4.
In the 2022 season, Albert Pujols became the fourth player. In the 2022 season, Albert Pujols became the fourth member of the 700 home run club in Major League Baseball history. Name the other three. And you got to name all three of them because this is an easy question.
So Hank Aaron, Barry Bonds, and Babe Ruth.
That is correct. Mm. All right. Each player has one question left. Neal, do you want to give a score update?
Yep, I'll give the score update here. So it's still pretty close. So Ian's got 4, and then Mark and David both tied with 6. And I believe we're going to do something after these final questions are read, but let's see how this pans out.
All right, so David, you only have 1 left, so here's 1. If who's on first and what's on second, who collects the first baseman's check at the end of the week?
Why is this a vaudeville act?
I feel like you're looking for the next line, but like it's been forever.
No, it's legitimately a question.
Yes, he does.
I'll take that. Yeah, sure. Because even though it's in the question, it's a lowercase w, not an uppercase. But the answer is who. And so I think we can all effectively say that David said who. That's okay. We're good with that.
I would have said yes.
Exactly.
That is a statement.
Because it asked the question with a lowercase w, but then the beginning it says who is on first. So, all right.
Yeah. Or it could be whose wife.
Yeah. Let's not talk.
That's the other part I was thinking about.
There you go. Yeah. Whose wife. There you go. Yeah.
Whose partner.
All right. Ian, 3 left. What current Milwaukee Brewer is one of the few players to have ever hit for the cycle 3 times in their career?
Christian Yelich.
That is correct.
Wow. Right off the bat.
Moving on to Mark, 3 left. William Contreras' use of the song Narco during walk-up and home runs has generated controversy because it's generally acknowledged that this song belongs metaphorically to what other player?
Got tap? I don't know.
All right. The answer is, just for fun, does anyone else know the answer?
Mm-mm.
It's Edwin Diaz, right? He's the relief pitcher for the Mets. All right. So that means we have, I believe we have David with 7, Mark with 6, and Ian with 5.
That's right. Yep. 5, 6, 7.
So we have 3 questions left. And I think we have, Neal and our brainstorming earlier today said that we would give everyone an opportunity to gamble their points that they've accumulated at the end here on how many we got 3 questions I have left here. So we could either do just 1 or we could do 2 or 3.
Let's do 1 of them. And then basically what you guys are going to do, you can wager any and all of your points for this question, we'll do that. Do you have a category, or you just want to go for the question, Matt?
Pitching consistency.
All right, so pitching consistency. We have David. You can wager up to 7. Ian up to 5. Mark up to 6. So, let us know your wagers.
I'm going all in.
All right, Ian's going all in.
I'll wager 5.
All right, 5 for Mark.
You know what? I was just glad I got 1 right. But I'm going to stick with Mark and go with 5 as well.
Okay. 5 across the board. Let's hear the question.
In 1992 to 1993, what pitcher set a major league record by losing 27 consecutive decisions? though he did convert 12 consecutive saves in the middle of the streak.
All right, Matt, you asked the question. All the competitors had a little bit of time to think about it. We have a wager of 5 across the board, and everyone submitted an answer. I will say every answer is a different name. So I'm going to say the names that were given to me, and then you can tell us what the correct answer is. Sure. All right, so coming from Mark, he says Dave Stewart, parentheses, it's wrong, LOL, but maybe it's right. We don't know. So Dave Stewart from Mark. and then we have David said Bobby Thigpen, and Ian, Trevor Hoffman. So 3 different answers.
Well, starting his career in 1991, getting the call-up with the New York Mets, he played 3 seasons with the Mets, if you count 1991 as a full season, even though he only played in, I think, a total of 10 games. He played 10 in 91, 52 in 92, and 39 in 93 with the Mets. Then he went to the Cubs for 2 seasons, and then he played for a couple of years, and I'm sorry, for 1 year, a couple of games in Houston. The answer to this question is Anthony Young. So no points.
Everyone
no
loses.
Points awarded. Say it, Matt. No, you're no points awarded, and may God have mercy on your soul.
And may God have mercy on your soul. Our final scores after the bottom of the ninth. Ian, a valiant effort. He bet everything to go all in, but he's going to end with 0. But he'll end with the hearts of fans all around the world. Mark, you're ending with 1. And then David is our champion today with 2 points. So congratulations. Great job, everyone. Great questions, Matt and company, Benchwarmers Trivia Podcast, and Ryan Myers. Thank you for all of those wonderful questions. Let's start with David. Any last shout-outs or anyone you'd like to tip your cap to before you exit the stadium?
Oh, I thought it was a great game. The questions were more difficult than I thought. I'm glad I was able to answer a few. And then Mark and Ian, you guys were great competition. It's been a pleasure. And yeah, just love what you guys do. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you for joining us. Ian, awesome for you to join us today. We'll have to hear more about your job. I do want to say this. This is the highest of compliments. Do not take this the wrong way. But you look very similar to Grant Gustin, who plays The Flash on TV, which is making me excited that you're on our screen, because you could get some money as a impersonator. So thank you for joining us, Ian. Any final words from you?
Well, fantastic. So I'm here and I should start a modeling career, so I'll get started on that. No, I just want to thank you guys. Honestly, it's been such a great time. I hope to get back at some point. Hopefully can put together a better performance next time. But no, still, thank you, Matt. Thank you, Matt. Thank you, Neil. Thank you, Mark and David. It was a great time.
Thank you so much for joining us. And Mark, coming to us from Oakland, namesake of the Oakland 5 here at Triviality. Thank you for joining us today. Any final words from you today?
Just thanks so much. I've been a longtime listener, and I really, really have been loving the show. So honored to be on. I remember when the 3 of us first got on, we're like, we're kind of just honored to be here. And so thanks for having us. And I can't believe this, but my wife helping me practice mascots actually helped today somehow. So I did not think 2 mascot questions would show up. I thought 1 would, but I'll take it.
Well, that's awesome. Well, thank you for saying those kind words. It's because of you and all the other listeners and patrons that allow us to do a fun bonus episodes like this and partner with other great podcasts like the Benchwarmers Trivia Podcast. So thank you all for joining us, because it just means a lot that we're able to do these really cool bonus episodes on just particular topics. Matt Dougherty, you gave us your time today and worked on all these questions and compiling them and getting everyone else to write them. So who would you like to shout out and thank you as always for playing the game with us?
Sure. Yeah, Eric Walling, David Lux, and Ryan Myers. Thank you to them. And I actually wrote a couple of questions too, so it's not like I'm totally, but do me a favor, everyone out there, go find your mom's phone and open up the podcast app and this, look for the podcast, Benchwarmers Trivia Podcast, and subscribe to it. It'll just automatically delete after a couple of days anyway. So don't worry about it. It's just I want the downloads. So, you don't even have to listen. It's fine.
Yeah, we could definitely do that. Well, thank you all of you.
Or go to the Apple store and do all the phones.
That's a better idea. Yeah, go to the Apple store. Jeff and Ken aren't here because, as Matt said, they don't like sports, and I think they're playing Magic or going on a quest somewhere. But Matt Arts, our sports guru of the podcast. I'll let you close it out. But before I give it to you, I just want to say that Triviality is an Airwave Media podcast. And if you go to airwavemedia.com, you can actually hear a lot of great shows just like this one, including Good Job Brain, The Accidental Creative, and Food with Mark Bittman. So make sure to go to airwavemedia.com to check out all those great shows along with ours. So Matt, feel free to close it out. You're the sports man. Any last words, and goodbye to our friends.
I think Matt should tell us who his favorite all-time crossover baseball and wrestler person.
I assume that this has probably got to be Pete Rose as well, getting tombstoned by Kane.
No, Randy Savage was.
Randy Savage played, minor league baseball over at Downers Grove North or South, one of the two. Mm-hmm. Macho Man, Randy Savage, cream of the crop. This was Triviality. Bye.
We've all been there. You're standing in a museum staring at a painting and all you can think is, I don't get it. To me, knowing the story behind an artwork is a huge part of knowing how to look at it. I'm Amanda, the host of the Art of History podcast, where we view history through the lens of some really great works of art. Each episode, we dive deep into the bigger picture behind some familiar and maybe not so familiar pieces. Check out Art of History now wherever you get your podcasts.